Hello and welcome to Casio Chaos Theory, and welcome to this video where we are going to take a look at this, a Casio VR1, the legendary and iconic little Casio that has made a number of cameo appearances on my channel, and it's also used in my channel logo, but I've not yet made it the feature of its own video. Today that will be addressed, as we are going to take a good look at its mysterious ADSR synth section, because this little Casio is actually a surprisingly flexible and programmable monophonic synthesizer. And similar to some of its other 80s MiniKeys Casio siblings, such as the SK1, MT400B, and CZ101, it can actually punch way above its weight. When I got my VR1 used back in 1982, I didn't get the user guide with it. Many people today buy a used VR1, and they're often missing the user guide. This means that programming the ADSR synth section can be rather confusing, as without knowing all the parameters and what they do, you won't know what you are programming into it. As such, many people, myself included, just entered random numbers into it and hoped to get lucky and find a good sound.
Oh, come on! Oh.
Today, you can do a Google search and find copies of the VR1 user guide online, but even with that, there is one part of entering the numbers to program the VR1's ADSR synth that can still confuse people. To help people understand the VR1's ADSR synth section, this video will cover the following. We'll take a brief look at the history and background of the VR1, attempt to determine the type of synthesis used, and have a look inside the VR1, demonstrate how to program the numbers into the ADSR synth section, explain how to program zeros into the front of the ADSR number string, examine the 8 synthesizer parameters available, demonstrate how the 0 to 9 parameter values affect sound by using visual scopes, examine and demonstrate the 9 VR1 waveforms using scopes, examine the 5 preset tones using scopes, reveal the undocumented secret LFO, and then we'll finish off with a conclusion. The Casio VR1, also known as the VL Tone, was released by Casio in the latter part of 1981, going by archived adverts and brochures found online. It was in many respects a revolutionary concept for an entry-level consumer musical instrument, by marrying a calculator with a monophonic synthesizer. And with the subsequent rise throughout the 1980s of digital synthesizers that used algorithms and mathematical calculations for sound generation, this showed that the little VR1 was actually well ahead of its time. It very quickly became a sales success and also a cultural icon, as well as making appearances on some major recordings of the time, most notably Trio's international hit single, Da Da Da, in 1982, and also appearing on the Human League's seminal 1981 album, Dare, where it featured on the track, Get Carter. You can see many more of its notable appearances by checking out its entry in my Top 10 Famous Casio Keyboards video. It also appears to have a connection with Casio's slightly earlier musical calculators that were first released around 1979 or so, though the VR1 greatly expanded on the musical feature set, and it appears to possibly use a similar sound generation. According to the Weltenschuler Table Hooters website, a great source of information and technical details regarding vintage Casios and other similar era home and toy keyboards, the VR1 supposedly has a monophonic sound generator based on multi-pulse square wave tones with different digital envelopes, and those are differently low-pass filtered through capacitors. The digital envelopes with audible zipper noise are linear and thus sound unrealistic because they fade silent too soon. At this point, I went to open up my VR1 so that I could film its internal circuits, but horror of horrors, I found that one of the batteries had started leaking. Luckily, I caught this early on, before much had leaked out, and the problem appeared to be confined to just one of the batteries. I cleaned everything and ensured that all the crustiness had been removed, especially the back of the battery cover that it was leaking down onto. I also removed the remains of the sticky label that once had some foam on it to support the batteries though this had disintegrated to dust many years ago. Even with the leaking battery, the VR1 was still functioning absolutely fine, so it goes to show how important it is to check batteries regularly and not to leave them installed in devices for extended periods of inactivity. Opening up the VR1 is very easy, as there are just a few screws to remove to separate the two halves, plus prising apart the two clips in the middle of the case. Taking a look at the circuits inside, there isn't much there surprisingly. The first board that we can see has an LA4140 amplifier, along with a number of capacitors, resistors, and a handful of diodes. The second board is seen from its bottom side, and we can also see the underneath of the main VR1 CPU. I undid the screws so I could show you the other side of this board, and I need to mention a couple of things at this point. This was one of the very last VR1 video segments that I filmed, as I was aware that there was a risk of damaging or dislodging the fragile zebra cable that connects the LCD display to this board. Anyway, once I flip the board over, you can see the D1867G CPU that is doing the heavy lifting for most, if not all, the VR1's features. You can also see, much to my dismay, that flipping up this board caused the zebra cable to detach itself from the board connectors. These heat and pressure connect zebra cables are a known issue with many, many aged devices that used LCDs, as they were simply a cheap and quick way of assembling components in a factory. Unfortunately, after a few years, the adhesive fails, leading to missing display segments, and in some cases, completely dead displays. A similar thing had already happened to one of my MG880 calculators in the video where I featured that model. They are also an almighty pain to try and reattach, as the zebra cables are meant for single use and are not easy to reattach once they come loose. There's not much inside a VR1 compared with the more heavily populated component layout found in contemporary analog mono synthesizers of the time, indicating that the VR1 likely uses a more digital form of sound generation and synthesis, mostly occurring within the D1867G's main CPU. And notably, it wouldn't be until 2 years later that polyphonic digital synthesizers became accessible and affordable to the general public, as popularized by the 1983 Yamaha DX7. Meanwhile, Casio had already been producing mass-market preset polyphonic home keyboards using some form of digital sound generation since 1980, and a little monophonic and mostly digital synthesizer in the form of the VR1 since 1981. Programming the VR1 is actually very easy, with only a couple of steps needed to create our own custom synth tone. If we look at the instrument select switch, we can choose from the 5 preset tones or the ADSR feature. If we move the switch to the ADSR position, the VR1 will play a tone generated by whatever numbers are currently stored in its memory. This memory is battery backed, so if you leave 4 AA batteries installed, the VR1 will remember the programmed ADSR tone even when switched off. To program your own tone into the ADSR memory, you move the power switch to the CAL position and put the VR1 into calculator mode. All the calculator functions behave exactly as you would expect, but we're not using the VR1's calculator to perform calculations. We are actually using the calculator's memory to perform and store the numbers for the ADSR synth tone. The VR1 has an 8-digit display, and each of those 8 digits corresponds to one of the 8 VR1 synth parameters, with each parameter having a value range from 0 to 9. To program your custom synth tone, you hit the MC Memory Clear button to erase any previously stored numbers. Enter the string of numbers of your ADSR synth tone into the calculator, and then you hit the Memory Plus button that will store the numbers seen on the screen into the calculator's memory. With your ADSR synth tone stored in the memory, you then move the power switch back to the play position. And also ensure that the tone selector switch is still on ADSR. When you now play the keyboard, you will hear your custom tone that you programmed into the VR1. Before we go any further, we also need to solve the mystery of how to enter an ADSR custom tone with zeros at the beginning of the string of numbers, because all of the 8 synth parameters can utilize the number 0 as an input value. For instance, let's say I want to program a synth tone using the following sequence of numbers: 0, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 0, 0. Most calculators will not display the number 0 as the first digit of a number, unless there is a decimal point involved. If I try to enter this number with a 0 at the front of the VR1, as you can see, the VR1's calculator simply ignores the 0. Why not use a decimal point then, I hear you cry? Well, that might allow you to enter what appears to be zeros in the front part of the number, but when programming and playing a custom tone using decimal points, it doesn't always program correctly, depending on the number entered. The correct way to enter an ADSR synth tone number string with zeros at the front is sort of explained on page 25 of the user guide. There it states, "Caution, if the first number is a 0, it will be ignored," and it then gives a couple of examples. I will elaborate on this and attempt to make it clearer, because many assume that the VR1 is reading the displayed number from left to right. What is actually happening is that the VR1 is reading the number from right to left, and that any blank entries are defaulted to a 0. For example, if I wanted to enter an ADSR tone with the following numbers, 000, 12345, I simply omit the 3 zeros at the front and just enter 12345. The VR1 will read the 3 empty digit spaces on the left of the screen as zeros. Therefore, it will see the number 12345 that I entered as 000, 12345, the full number sequence that I want to program into the VR1's ADSR tone. To demonstrate why you should use the omitting front zeros method of entering numbers and not use a decimal point, let's go back to the previous number we tried to enter, 012345, 00. If I program this number in as 0.123450, notice that when I hit the memory plus button, the number loses the 2 zeros on the right and shifts the remaining numbers to the right, completely changing the parameters for our intended custom tone. Now take a listen to how it sounds when I play it back. I will now enter that same number into the VR1, except this time I will use the correct procedure of entering numbers. Notice that when I press the M plus button, we don't lose the 2 zeros on the end and the number isn't shifted. When I play the ADSR tone now, notice that it is different to the tone we previously programmed using a decimal point. Therefore, when programming your custom tone into the VR1, always use the omit the front zeros method and do not use decimal points. Now that we know how to program the numbers for a custom synth tone into the ADSR section, the next thing we need to do is take a look at the 8 synth parameters that make up a tone. It's also worth pointing out that without the user guide, many people mistakenly thought that there were only 4 parameters, corresponding to the classic 4-stage ADSR envelope shape and the ADSR you see screen printed on the VR1's case. With the VR1 using double that number of parameters for tone generation, let's see what they are. Parameter 1 is for selecting one of the 10 sound waves available, each with a name describing an instrument or a type of sound. We can see a list of these waves by looking at page 24 of the user guide, and we'll examine each of these waves in more detail later on in the video. Parameters 2 to 6 are attack, decay, sustain level, sustain time, and release, and these are used for generating an envelope. Page 24 of the VR1 user guide also shows the basics of building a sound and details the use of ADSSR to generate an envelope. And yes, the VR1 uses the 5-stage ADSSR envelope, not a 4-stage ADSR envelope, as per the ADSR we've already seen screen printed on the VR1's case. And the last two parameters, 7 and 8, set the amount of vibrato and tremolo used in the sound. Page 25 of the user guide informs us that a value of 0 equals no effect, and that increasing the value causes the greater amount of the effect to be applied. Unfortunately, there is no parameter to specifically affect the speed or depth of the LFO used for vibrato and tremolo. We can only program the combined amount of the effect that is applied. Those are the 8 synthesizer parameters used to generate a custom tone in a VR1. Let's now hear and see what we can do with them. With the knowledge of how to program the VR1's ADSR synth, and also knowing all of its programming parameters, let's use some visual scopes so that we can see, as well as hear, what is happening when we enter different values into the various parameters when programming our own sounds. For our bass waveform, I'm going to use waveform number 3, the flute, as it has the minimal amount of built-in vibrato. This is the number that I programmed into the VR1 that includes some sustain and release, so that we can have a good look and listen at the waveform we will use. This is what waveform number 3, the flute, sounds like. Now I will set all the flute waveform synth parameters to 0 so that we can see and hear what happens when we start building a custom synth tone from scratch. To do this, I have programmed the following number into the VR1, and this is how the flute waveform sounds with everything zeroed. With the envelope parameters at their lowest and fastest settings, it kind of sounds like the lead synth from Popcorn. Let's increase the envelope attack to the middle setting and see what that does. Well, we can clearly see there that we now have some attack occurring in the envelope, but there's absolutely nothing else. You've got an attack. As you can see, that's slope, then everything cuts off. So let's increase the attack to the maximum value and see what that does. We can definitely see there's been an increase in the attack time there. It's not a massive difference, but it is noticeable. Now let's increase the decay to the middle setting. Quite clearly, we now have some decay in our envelope with a very noticeable attack coming in and then the decay coming down. And about at the moment, it's ever so slightly more. The middle setting for the decay is slightly longer than the maximum attack. And now let's try the decay at the maximum value. Once again, we can see that there definitely has been an increase in that attack, in the decay. And it's much longer than the maximum attack. As we said, it's a bit longer. But you look again at the actual envelopes, you can see the steppiness in there. Definitely some stepping. Okay, so we've done the attack and decay. Now let's try some sustain. Moving on to sustain level and sustain time, these work in conjunction with each other and also with the envelope release. Sustain primarily affects how the sound plays when a key is held down, and release affects the sound when a key is released. I'm going to increase the sustain level to the middle setting. Now, this is interesting because what's actually happening here is that we've just set the sustain level to the middle setting. So what's happening is that instead of the decay just following all the way out until the sound fades out completely, it's dropping down to the level we set the sustain to begin. But it's cutting off because there's no sustain time. You can see that here. That halfway point, even if I hold my finger down, makes no difference. So it's missing the sustain time to give it time to fade out. So let's increase the sustain time to the middle setting and see what that does. Now this is doing the same thing as it was doing before because I'm not holding the key down. And as mentioned, the sustain time is primarily affects when you hold the key down. So let's see what happens when I hold the key down and play it. But now we can see the sustain time taking effect. We got attack, decay, and sustain time. With the sustain level, rather, starting at about the halfway point in the waveform, and then fading out with the amount of sustain time we've given it. Now let's max out the sustain level and sustain time and try that. Now, as you probably noticed in this time, it looks like we only have attack, but what's happening here is the attack envelope is going to, it's reaching the end of attack and then starts to decay, but we set the sustain level right at the very top, the maximum amount. So that's when it's beginning. And once again, I'm not holding down a key and there's no release part of the envelope, so it just cuts off. But if I hold my finger down on a key, we now have basically infinite sustain. It will play the note for as long as I'm holding a key down. And as soon as I let go, it will stop. And as mentioned, there's no release time, so it's just going to cut off at the end of me picking my finger up. So let's try increasing the release time to the middle setting. And right now you can see the release is kicking in. And there's the sustain part is not really doing much, but it's still there because if I hold the key down, and there's notice this time it's holding the sustain, maxing out the sustain as long as I hold a key down, and as soon as I let go, it will play the release part of the envelope. So we've got attack, sustain while I'm holding the key down, and then release, very steppy again. And let's try it with the maximum amount of release. Yes, we can really see there that the release time is doubled from pretty much what it was previously. And it's doing the same thing with the sustain level and sustain time. What attack, go into sustain. And then the release will kick in as soon as I let go with a very long release. So we've got a fairly middling attack here with infinite sustain when I hold the key down and the longest release. To finish off the envelope section, let's decrease sustain time down one notch from 9 to 8. And for this one, I'm going to hold the key down when I play it. So it's going to go and straight in and play the whole of the sustain part of the envelope. And you should be able to see there, it goes attack straight into sustain because the sustain level is maxed out. So it's coming in straight away. So it's normally go attack and then it will decay down to whatever level I've set the sustain level at, but the sustain level is at the same level that the decay part of the envelope would start. So we actually don't have any decay. But also notice that what you see there is just the sustain part of the envelope. There's no release. If I let go, there is no release because there's no volume left to release with. But if I let go of the key partway through the sustain part of the envelope, then I kick in the release part. So you have a surprising amount of almost flexibility and expressiveness with this simple little VR1 using its envelope, especially the way you can trigger the sustain part almost at will, depending on what settings you use with it. And the last two parameters we're going to look at are the vibrato and tremolo. And I've set it up this sound here, which is the flute preset again. This is just simply to show you what it sounds like with no vibrato or tremolo added. So that's our basic waveform, the waveform number 3, the flute preset. So let's try and add some vibrato to it. So we're going to start off with the smallest amount of vibrato using a value of 1. Well, there is some there, a small amount. Vibrato affects the pitch, and it's very, very fast. It's very, very subtle. And if you look at the edges of the vectorscope, or the envelopes on the vectorscope, then you can see these kind of little fuzzy edges to it. And you can also see the waveform and the oscilloscope. There's a little like quivering going on there. So let's increase the vibrato to the middle setting and see what that does. So we can really hear something going on there. It's definitely more pronounced this time. It's a deeper amount of the effect that's been applied. But notice the rate is a little bit slower. That last note sounded a bit like Pac-Man. So interestingly, yes, it's as we're going more depth with the effect, the actual rate slows down. So let's try maxing out the vibrato setting and see how that sounds. Again, we can see and hear that rate has slowed down with the depth going deeper. So we've got a deeper amount of vibrato being applied, but we've got a slower rate of the LFO, which isn't an LFO, it doesn't actually have an LFO. But that's an interesting observation. That the more of the effect the more the vibrato is applied, the slower the rate of the actual modulation, the LFO, as I said. So let's try the tremolo parameter now. And tremolo, as mentioned, is the volume part, whereas vibrato is pitch. So the tremolo should change the volume depending on the amount that we set it to. So I'm going to start off with the lowest amount of tremolo, which is 1. Let's see what that does when we try it. Now, again, it's noticeable. In fact, I would say the number 1 setting for the tremolo is more noticeable than the number 1 setting for vibrato. You can just about hear it, but you can definitely see it more. You can see the more quivering with the oscilloscope. But then with the waveform vectorscope, you really see those fuzzy edges. So it's similar with the vibrato as well. The rate is very fast, but the depth of the effect isn't so much. So let's increase the tremolo to the middle setting. That's very much more apparent now. And also, there's a little something you can do with this one, apart from the fact that you can really, really see now. Very, very, very clearly through the waveform part in the on the vector scope. But if I go to the lower octave, watch this. I can draw Christmas trees. There's one. I could do a better one than that. Wow. Big Christmas tree. Christmas tree on top of a Christmas tree. So this is with tremolo. You can draw sideways Christmas trees. Okay, let's what are we gonna do now? We're going to try the maximum amount of tremolo. Once again, we can really see a difference. The depth has increased. Oh, it almost went on. I thought it wasn't going to stop there. That's interesting. Normally it repeats that many times. Sometimes it repeats more than others. Like that. But anyway, so you can see, similar to the vibrato, that the greater the depth of the effect, the slower the rate of the LFO, of the modulation part of it. So, yes, that's interesting and very noticeable. Those are the 8 synthesizer parameters that you have available to you when programming the VL1's ADSR synthesizer section. And hopefully through this brief overview, I've been able to show you some of its capabilities and some of the range of possibilities that you have when programming your own sounds into the VL1. Now we're going to take a look at the 10 waveforms available. And we're going to use our scopes to have a look and see what's going on and see if we can identify what kind of waveforms are being used and what kind of frequency range that we can get out of them. And the first waveform is waveform 0, which is the piano. Now that's the piano waveform, and yes, it's sort of a definitely square wavy, especially at the lower frequencies, but at the high frequencies, gets almost triangly, sawtoothy, just a little bit. But most definitely, that's a square wave bass, and it's quite bassy as well. If I go down to the lower octave, it's just peaking the lowest frequency, about 100 hertz. So you could use that as a baseline. Now we're going to look at waveform number 1, which is the fantasy waveform. Once again, we very much have that square wave. Apparent that it is based on a square wave. It's similar to the piano, but the same thing, go up to the higher frequencies. It sort of starts looking triangly and sawtoothy, but it's not as bassy. Because notice the lowest frequency is about 200 hertz. It's a nice sound, but not as bassy as the piano. Waveform number 2 is the violin waveform. that is a interesting waveform because it's quite nasally, but there's a lot going on there. It's like there's mixing up some square wavy stuff with a bit of triangle, a bit of sawtooth. There was probably the square multipath square waves, as it's been described as on the Table Hooters website. It's quite nasally sounding as well, as I mentioned. It's, let's say, when, and frequency wise, it's very, very mid range. It's the peak is, I'm looking at my scope, is about 600 hertz, the actual peak of it, with some lower frequencies around about 400 hertz. Another interesting sound there, another interesting waveform. Moving on to waveform number 3, the flute waveform. Well, that one is, once again, very square wave based, and it's actually quite similar to the CZ-101 square wave, and you can see in my Casio CZ-101 versus CZ-1 video. It's got some quite good bass on this. Yeah, this is peaking the lowest frequency about 100 hertz there. But you could use this as a bass line, just about. It's a bit of a shame it doesn't go down one more octave. Now let's try waveform number 4, guitar 1. That one, I think, it looks like an inverted pulse, loosely based on maybe the Casio CZ-101 inverted pulse and the CZ phase distortion series. It's probably square wave based. You could sort of see it's modified from a square wave, I think. It's quite growly at the low end frequencies. It's a little bit nasally at the high end. You can really see that sort of inverted pulse thing, but there's some very interesting shapes going on there. Not a lot of bass. Again, this one is mostly, it's quite middling, but it's sort of 200 to 300 hertz is the lowest end. As low as it will go. So not really a sound that's useful for bass lines. Waveform number 5 is guitar 2. Well, that one is quite different from the guitar 2. It's quite different from guitar 1. There's all sorts of things going on in this waveform. It seemed to be that square wave mixed with a bit of a sawtooth triangle wave. It's certainly multiple things going on in there. But similar to guitar one, it's quite growly at the low end. And I think it gets, very interesting at higher frequencies. But the lowest end, it goes to about 200 hertz there, so it's another growly sound, not really suitable for a bass line. Waveform number 6 is the English horn. Well, that's another, sort of looks a bit, almost like the inverted pulse again that we saw in guitar 1. In waveform number 4, though it looks to be modified square wave again, as you're looking at that, certainly at the lower end of the frequencies. Very much looks like an inverted pulse at the higher end. And the lowest frequencies go down to about 200 hertz again. It's quite growly, once again, not really a bass line sound, but it's another interesting waveform you could use, probably. Waveform number 7 is one of the three electro sound waveforms, and this one is electro sound number 1. Now that's sort of another interesting waveform there. It's like it's jumping, this is an octave jumping. With different octaves going on, but it's definitely that square wavy again. Interesting. So that's electro sound number 1. And frequency wise. There's a little bit, it's peaking at around about 400 hertz. And the low end, the lower part of the octave, looks to be about 100 hertz. Probably could use this like a sort of a octave jumping arpeggiated bass, maybe. Waveform number 8 is electro sound 2. And this is similar to number 7 with the jumping octaves. So it looks like it's a higher octave because we seem to be getting more of that sort of triangle sawtooth looking waveform mixed with the modified pulse waveform at the low end. High frequencies. And frequency wise, the lowest is about 200 hertz. So it's kind of similar to the first one, but it's just different octaves and something slightly different, possibly going on with the upper waveform, but maybe just how it looks when it goes up an octave or higher octaves. And the last waveform is waveform number 9, which is electro sound 3. Now, this has got a more interesting kind of waveform going on. It's more complicated. It's very similar to the waveform number 4. But with the jump in octaves, and frequency-wise, a low octave pair, looks like it's peaking around 400 hertz as the lowest end of it, so you couldn't really use this as a jumping bass sound. It's kind of a bit nasally. There is some information below 400 hertz, but not as much. It's not peaking, it's not really bassy. So really those last three sounds, the electro sounds, are variations of the same thing with the jumping octave using slightly different waveforms or using different amounts of the octaves between the two. And to finish off our sound analysis, we're going to look at the 5 preset tones available in the VR1. Just to see if we can identify what is going on with the waveforms and with the frequencies. Preset number 1 is the piano sound. So that's the classic VR1 piano preset zone, and it's got some nice bass around about that 100 hertz area. It's nice rounded and it's quite punchy. And you could probably use this for a bit of a bass line. And I don't know, maybe you could use it for a little bit of Depeche Mode. Maybe you could even use it for a bit of Trio's Da Da Da. Da, da, da. And preset number 2 is the famous fantasy sound. And that's very clearly square wave based again, as most of the sounds are in the VR1. It's got a low frequency of around about 200 hertz. Got a fairly fast attack with some sustain or just decay going on there. It's a nice sound, but a little bit vibrato. And I don't know, maybe we could do a bit of Yazoo with this. Or maybe we could even use it to play some Human League. And next we have the violin preset. That's pretty much the same as waveform number 2, which is a sort of a square mix, sort of square pulse mix. Or saw mix, I'm not sure. But yeah, that's one of the more complex waveforms there with added vibrato. Bass-wise, not much at all. This is pretty much a mid-range sound. I don't know, what could we do this one for? Maybe a bit more Depeche Mode again. Maybe we need some new life here. Okay, preset number 4 is the flute. Let's have a listen to that one. That is pretty much the same as Soundwave 3, which is very, very much a square wave looking waveform. They're modified square wave. This one has got quite a bit of bass, same as Soundwave number 3. And we see right down there the 100 hertz area. So we could use this as bass. It's kind of nice. It's got a bit of vibrato going on. Yeah, you can see with the oscilloscope or the waveform, it sort of quivers. So there's a little bit of vibrato going on in there. It's got a little bit of attack and decay, middling attack and decay, and a fast release. Now, I wonder, maybe I'm feeling a bit of Newman with this one. And the final preset that we're going to look at is the guitar. And this one looks very similar to Soundwave number 4, which is guitar 1. And it's a sort of a pulse-looking waveform again. Very much a pulse-based waveform based around a square wave again, which... that's simply what the VR1 uses here. Very fast attack. And decay with a short sustain. Quite growly. And again, there's not much in the way of low frequencies. Lowest is around about 250 hertz there, looking at my spectrum analyzer. Anyway, what can I fill with this one? Maybe a bit of Human League again. And those are the 5 famous preset tones you get with your classic VR1. Bonus feature, the secret LFO. Though I've said throughout this video that the VR1 doesn't have an LFO, it doesn't officially have one and it's not documented. However, there are some ways of actually adjusting the speed of the tremolo, vibrato, and also the rate of modulation for three of the waveforms, electrosound 1 to 3, which is waveform 7 to 9. And I'm going to show you how to do that. First off, let's have a look at how we can change the speed of the vibrato and the tremolo. And I should point out as well that I don't take credit for this at all. This was discovered, or I learned about it, through the Keen on Keys VL10 review video. And so I'm going to show you what happened. So we're going to play the sound, and this is the sound with the maximum amount of vibrato added. And you should be able to see there the vibrato taking effect, causing that pulsing effect, which is quite clear to see in those scopes. However, I'm going to play it again, except this time I'm going to hold down one of the tempo buttons. Watch what happens, and watch the scopes when I do this. And you should be able to see there that the rate actually increases. I'm going to do the same thing, except this time we're going to use the tremolo, and I've maxed the tremolo out using this number, which is exactly the same as the previous sound that we just played, except I've now maxed out the tremolo and turned off the vibrato. And as before, I'm going to do the same thing, except now I'm going to press the tempo buttons while it's playing. And once again, you should be able to see that the especially the envelope, how much closer the peaks become. So you get a little bonus feature there. You can actually change the speed of the modulation by increasing it a notch, but that's all you can do. But it's an undocumented feature. The other secret LFO affects the last three waveforms. This is waveform 7 to 9, which are called electrosound 1 to 3. And these are the waveforms which have that jump in octave feature. So this is the number I programmed in with which we're going to use electrosound number 1. And this is what it normally sounds like. As you can clearly see from the scopes that the jumping and by the peaks and the troughs in the all three of the little graphs there. But I'm going to start you touching the tempo buttons, or pushing them rather. I'm not going to hold them, I'm going to push them. And watch what happens to the rate of the octave jump. Quite clearly, you can see and hear that the rate has slowed down. And in fact, you can also see the tempo change on the display. And that's the slowest it will go. It's now 10 steps, 9 steps, 10 steps below normal. But of course, I can go 10 steps above normal as well. Pretty fast rate there. That's the secret LFO that you can use to slightly increase the speed of the tremolo and vibrato, and also quite dramatically increase and decrease the speed of the octave jumping for the electrosound 1 to 3 waveforms. The Casio VL1 really is quite an incredible little box of tricks for its time, especially when considering its price point and market sector, where there was absolutely nothing else available that came even close to having a comparable feature set. I also hope that, with this video, I've been able to show you the range of capabilities the VR1 synthesizer has, and also how to program it to get the most out of it. For sure, it is quite limited in terms of overall sonic character, its relatively small parameter ranges, and it does have noticeably steppy envelopes, but by using its quite varied range of 10 preset waveforms, along with the envelopes, tremolo, vibrato, and octave switch, you get a surprisingly wide breadth of potential sounds available to you. Of course, it's not going to replace a Mini Moog, Arp Odyssey, SH-101, or any of the classic analog mono synthesizers also available back in that era. However, the little VR1 was, and still is, a fraction of the cost of those iconic mono synths, and in some situations, can actually give them a little bit of a run for their money. So if you want to add some distinctive and vintage VR1 sonic mojo to your recordings, go grab one of these easy to find, relatively inexpensive and iconic little Casios and party like it's 1981 again. Oh, and if your VR1's LCD display is fully functional, don't disturb the circuit board that it's attached to. Even though the musical part of mine remains fully functional, and I can still program the ADSR synth without a working display, I can only hope that I can find a way of repairing the display and getting it fully working again. And that's it for this video. As always, thank you very much for watching, and if you enjoyed what you've seen, please don't forget to hit the like and subscribe buttons, and also ring the bell so you get notified of new videos when they're uploaded. Oh, and remember, keep it Casio.